Okay, I'm going to introduce the panel. Far left, I'll start left to right. Far left is Ben Hamlet. Ben Hamlet is an instructor down here at the College of Southern Idaho. Next to Ben Hamlet is Lori Lickley, who's from she's one of our industry partners, who's been involved in our alignment piece. She's from the ag community, and so she was involved in the ag alignment down here. Evan Moore is next. He's from North Idaho College. He's one of our transition coordinators, so he'll be working with our high school students as they transition from that high school environment to the post-secondary environment. Cindy Arnzen is a business education teacher out of the Nampa School District. She teaches an applied accounting program. Next here is Polly Knudsen. Polly Knudsen is, I believe, it's College Southern Idaho, right? Lewis Clark State College, I'm sorry. Norm Markham is next to her. He is an instructor out of the Boise School District, auto mechanics, and then Susan Johnson, representing the state division, who has been working feverishly for this on this for the last 2.5 years. So appreciate them being here. As Dwight reflected in his PowerPoint this morning, or in his presentation this morning, the number one goal of alignment, because I know a lot of you are saying, why are we doing this? Why do we need to do this? The number one goal of alignment is to transition our high school concentrators from our high school technical programs into our post-secondary technical programs. Currently, on a nationwide basis, that transition takes place nationwide at about a rate of about 11 to 12%. So about 12% of our high school seniors who have completed a high school CTE program move into a technical program at the college level. In Idaho, that number is about 5%. Our typical student in a post-secondary technical college is 28 years old. We want to see that age bracket scale down a little bit. We need to move our students through. We do not have enough students to fill the occupational need that our industry has. One particular example before we get started is the diesel technician environment in the state of Idaho. In the state of Idaho, diesel industry needs about 225 to 240 new employees every year as technicians. We currently graduate from our post-secondary institutions about 70. We have approximately 4 diesel programs in the high school environment. So one of our goals is to, number one, grow diesel programs at the secondary level and transition those high school students into those post-secondary programs so that they can move on into those fields of being technicians. So that's some of the things. Let's get started with the questions. I'm going to ask a question first, Polly Knudsen. Number one, what made you decide to participate in the alignment process?
Well, first I was told I had to.
I was a brand new faculty member and was sent down to the meeting. After I attended the first meeting, I realized how extremely important it was to be a part of the process. It's a frustrating process, and it's an awesome process, but it's frustrating because you see how misaligned things are. And so it's really critical to be involved in the process so that you're part of, so you know what everybody else is doing. So you know what the secondary level is doing and your other post-secondary programs. So it's been a great process.
Laura, I'd like to ask the same question to you. Why does an industry member get involved in this process that we're doing?
Well, thank you for that question. And most of you are aware that agriculture is the number one contributor to this state's economy, and specifically animal agriculture. And we recognize that we have to have a certain skill set to meet the requirements of that government demand. And that is one of the reasons that I agreed to participate in this panel. We've got a very large packing plant coming into Idaho within the next 365 days. I had the opportunity just recently to ask one of the partners in that packing and processing facility if he had enough skilled laborers to meet the demand or meet his workforce requirements. And he said it's going to be challenging. So this is one of the reasons that I agreed to participate in this panel.
Thank you. Also, we have open mics down here at the front of the stage, just like yesterday. So if any of you have a question that you want to bring to this panel related to the alignment process, please step down to the front, and as soon as you get there, we'll recognize you for that question. Until then, we'll continue with some of our questions that we've created for the panel. So Cindy, from your perspective, what do you see as the greatest benefit of the program alignment for secondary students?
I feel the greatest benefit is that my kids know that when they leave high school, they can go on to college, and they can see the streamlined process before. I feel like the kids felt like what they were learning in high school did not necessarily match to what they were learning in college. And now with the county, we have aligned all of our standards, and so basically they can skip kind of the first semester of accounting and go into the second semester of accounting. And I know a lot of my students come back and say, you know what, it's been great because what you taught me in high school, I already knew in post-secondary, and it's made my life a lot easier. So I think it's been a great process. As Polly said, it's been hard, but I think the benefit of the kids will see the benefit of it.
Great, thank you. Evan, it's a question for you because I think it's really, how do you see the alignment process affecting the interconnectivity between the secondary and post-secondary programs as we continue to move forward in this activity?
Great question, Steve. And I wanted to answer the first one, actually, why we decided to participate.
No problem. Go back to the first one.
Because you made us.
Why did you participate? Yeah.
Because you made us. And rightfully so, and thankfully so. The importance of guided pathways and exposure to students has been huge. And that's been my experience when I stepped into high schools, is just awareness. Mr. Perna talked about it yesterday. They don't know what they don't know. And this is just one way to really get a great idea of what we have to offer in the schools. Never before has tried so hard to align programs, to push high school students to go on to college. We've got hospital initiatives, we've got SkillSec, and this is just another piece. So I find it extremely important, albeit very difficult. Getting very smart people in the same room trying to figure out one objective, many of them hard-headed and confident, and very well able to. But I know it's for the greater good. Positive changes that are going to come will train them. And that will be secondary students matriculating to post-secondary institutions to learn technical skills that will carry them on to careers. Period.
Great, thank you. Yeah. Norm, I'd like to ask you the same question. What do you see is that, because you've been through the process now, what do you see is that interconnectivity now between you and your post-secondary partners?
Well, for us, being involved in this is very beneficial. Not only did we align our program with post-secondary programs, we also aligned our standards to industry, what industry wanted us to focus on. So through this process, we were able to see areas that maybe we didn't need to focus so much on and other areas that we needed to pick up on. So we were actually able to update those standards a little bit. Now we can tie our lesson plans to relevant standards to create that entry-level employee.
Great, thanks. Then, from a post-secondary perspective, how do you see the alignment process, and how has it done so far? We're still very new into this, but how do you see the alignment process strengthening your program in the future?
Okay, so it actually helps to where, I know that I've had students that have transferred to other colleges, and it's difficult for them to actually fit into theirs because the classes don't match. So aligning it will actually help students to shift between, say, CSI to CWI or ISU and to move around a little bit, which they tend to be doing a lot more.
Great, thanks. Any questions from the field yet? Nothing from the field. I know you guys have questions, so please come down and ask them open-ended questions if you have. I'll ask another question. Actually, I haven't picked on Susan yet. So Susan, you've been involved in this now for about 2.5 years. We started in 2014, we started the standards alignment process with the first group of programs. So as other programs begin this alignment process, as we know we have at least 2 more years of alignment. And then we've got other programs moving through the system now. So as we begin that next round of alignment, what would be your single biggest piece of advice for them moving forward?
Get involved. You know, I've been sort of, I always laugh, I'm the person who shows up and I'm cracking the whip to make sure that we get things done. But this watching the teachers work together is just an amazing experience. I think all of them would agree, just the networking of talking to their cohorts in the field, secondary talking to post-secondary, and just everybody talking to each other about their program. It's a very positive experience. And then when industry is sitting at the table to hear them talking, it's just amazing to see everyone work together and their professionalism as they're working together. It's been a lot of hard work, but it's probably been one of the most positive things I've done in my career. Oh, and if you're a teacher coming to the table, when we're asking you to bring industry representatives, please be very seriously working with your advisory committees or former students and trying to get them to the table, because this is, the industry input is so valuable to what we're doing.
Can I break in there?
You bet.
I have one piece of advice. Go to the meetings. Everybody, your division chair or whatever, they say, oh, you gotta go to this meeting. Go to the meetings, because they're actually, they've helped me so much, and the connecting with the secondary teachers and just the networking and understanding the programs better from all of the institutions, it's been very valuable. So go to the meetings.
How about from a secondary perspective, what kind of advice would you give folks who get involved?
I think I really have enjoyed sitting next to Polly. She also teaches accounting, and we have been able to share lesson plans. She's, accounting is kind of a subject matter that the kids aren't really interested in it. But we're coming with ideas to get kids interested in it. And before this process, I didn't even know who Polly was, and we didn't even get it. I knew was the one that I knew dual credit with. So I've had a hell of a lot more network of teachers that I can bounce ideas off, and I don't know how to teach an area, they can come in and help me. So it's been a great networking part that I could not create.
Yeah, I agree with that as well. We were able to accomplish a lot sitting at the table together. Very interesting process. In fact, we were even involved in creating some of the test questions that our students will be utilizing. So that was very important, very interesting. Getting everybody to use the same roadmap, I think, is very crucial. And then the data that we get from those tests, we can go back to our peers and maybe find out an area that they're successful in and find out how they're doing it. Share those lessons plans with each other, because the ultimate goal is to see our students stay in Idaho and have a seamless transition from secondary to post-secondary. We want to keep them in state, we want to get them higher to stay in state as well, so that's our goal there.
Lori, I'll come back to you as an industry person. You gave us a good idea of why you decided to participate, but what do you see as the greatest benefit for industry through this process as we continue to accomplish these different pathways? What do you see as the greatest benefit for industry?
Well, see, I think the greatest benefit is the fact that the secondary and post-secondary segments of our education system, recognize and officially implementing some of the standards, while not perfect, as we've realized in this process, and frustrating and challenging at times, actually do really provide a valuable template for these high school students that will serve those of us in industry and have that skill set, some of that foundation, that solid foundation, and that toolbox that is so critical to helping us continue in agriculture and provide that food fiber that sustains each and every one of us every day, as well as takes care of the, as I mentioned, the Idaho economy.
Great. Steve, can I add to that? Yes. Well, it's so important to remember that much of what we do at NICD, community colleges, has is guided by advisory committees. and what the industry is doing. And that's why it's so important that we're tuned with that. We make minor adjustments as much as we can, as quickly as we can, depending on what the industry demands in an employee. So we can get those kids ready and at contracts, ready to go out there and work. So much of what trickles down in the vertical alignment is really coming from industry too. It's important that the secondary institutions understand that, where that's coming from. It's not some idea in the cloud, it's actually industry.
You know, we're all tied up in meetings. I'm tied up in helping operate a fourth generation farm and ranch, and not only I'm open to that as well, and currently serving as the Idaho Cattle Association's president this year. But I find it really critical that all of us in the industry take time to sit down with folks just like you and help you solve the problems and the solutions to making that next generation of skilled workers. So please reach out to us. There are many of us that are actually available and appreciate the opportunity to be involved.
There's a question. That question is for my two post-secondary instructors. And I'll go with Ben first, and we'll say, Ben, how has this process strengthened your relationship with the other post-secondary institutions that offer the same program that you do?
Well, with the other institutions, it's been able to talk to them, find out what they do, get more ideas for projects and labs that I wouldn't have had myself. Good interaction with them.
I'd echo what you said, but also, you know, the sharing of resources and tackling of problems. I did went through a curriculum process and worked with Michelle at NIC, and it was awesome. It's just all the connections and the sharing.
Great. So we have somebody at the mic down here. Please
right.
Go ahead and ask your question.
My name is Terry, and I teach up in Northern Idaho in Post Falls at an Idaho High School. And my question is, it sounds like there's a lot of really great work done, but as someone who's not involved in the committee, where do we see this work being done? I know there's a new website and all that, and yesterday during our business program, she showed us how to get somewhere, but the website is brand new, and it's hard to navigate it, and I haven't had a chance to really go out through it. So it's like, is there a spot on the website that shows us where all this alignment work is being done so that we can see some of this great work?
If you go out to cte.idaho.gov and under the educators link, within that educators link, you'll find another link for standards. And what you'll see when you click on the standards link will be the standards for all of the different programs that have been aligned so far. Now, you saw the list that Dwight put up on the board for 2016. We've completed one round of alignment. What really a lot of folks don't understand is to go through the entire alignment process, from the time we start writing, bringing the industry in, and we start writing the initial standards or student learning outcomes for the secondary side, and then we move into creating the criticality survey for industry to tell us how important each of those learning outcomes are. Then we develop the assessment, the technical skills assessment that's going to go along with that. Then we bring in the post-secondary institutions to align their particular programs so that first semester is accessible to our secondary students, so that we can write those technical competency credit opportunities for those students. Then they take that information back to their curriculum committees at the post-secondary institutions and have to go through usually somewhere between a 6-month and 9-month process to move those courses, because sometimes it requires course changes, activity changes, course name changes, moving courses from second semester into first semester. So that process usually takes that next full year. So then, only then can we come back and then start offering these classes to our students. At least from we're still teaching them at the secondary level, but now we can start offering for those technical competency credits. Well, that process takes about 2 years. So we started this initial process with those first 9 that Dwight had on his board that are going to be training tomorrow. We started that process in the fall of 2014. And so summer of 2016, we are now going to bring secondary teachers in, and the post-secondary instructors are going to help those secondary teachers find the weaknesses in their programs based on the test scores that our students went through this last spring. And then hopefully this next fall, we will begin offering our first round of credit for all of those students. So it's a quite a process. It's a very long process, it's very drawn out. But as you go out on that website and you look under standards, you will see the first 22 that we've done. And the second 13 are still in that process. But the first 9 are complete now, and we're getting ready to start offering technical competency credit this next year. Okay? I hope that answers your question. Thanks, Rachel.
I was just going to say, I know where it is on our old website, and I don't have our new website committed to memory, but it's educators, and then I believe it's programs, and then under there it's standards. But always feel free to call our office or send us an email too, and we can send you that link. So the standards are there, and then the industry criticality surveys are also there with the standards. And I think that's really interesting for the teachers to go in and look at how industry responded to what we thought was important and to what they really think is important. So I would look at both documents, definitely.
And Katie wants to step in here real quick on the new website. She's the one who's most familiar because she's been doing most of the design on the new website.
I just want to say, I know it's really difficult to navigate something that's completely new. If you can think of one word that would be on the page that you're looking for instance, standards, you will be able to find it. Just use the search function. The website's completely searchable. So just think about one word, put it into the search, and it'll pull up what you need.
Your question, please. Who are you? Where are you from? What level do you teach?
I teach here at CSI. I'm a welding instructor. Let me first start by saying I'm a huge advocate of this horizontal vertical alignment. But is anybody thinking about, we're full in welding, and I think everybody else is full. We have industry saying more people, but we're full. Short of knocking down a wall, adding more to our shop, are we thinking about this? My whole thought process in this is I don't want to have a student and give him these credits and him come and sit in my office and say, I got these credits, and me look at him and say, well, we're full. I can't do anything for you. Does that make sense?
Totally.
So is there anybody thinking about, hey, how can we expand our seating in college?
Yes, and that's a great question. I know it's not necessarily the panel, but as some of you may have known, and I think in Dwight's presentation, great question, thanks a lot. In Dwight's presentation, I'm not sure you can watch all of it, I don't know if he covered it, but this last year, we received, I think, $2.4
million.
$3.6 million specifically to expand programs at the post-secondary level who have waiting lists. So we focused on 5 major areas in the post-secondary environment. Manufacturing was one of them, which includes welding, health professions, IT, aeronautics,
transportation.
And through the use of those funds, we're hiring more faculty. We're creating more opportunities for students to come through. The goal was to eliminate those waiting lists of students sitting out there on that waiting list. Perfect example there. Student coming in, can't get on, I have to sit and wait for a year, or I have to wait for a semester because I can't get into a class. And so we're hoping that the post-secondary institutions have taken advantage of that, and we're guessing this fall they're going to be implementing some of that movement so that we can really grow those students in.
Just let me tell you, and this goes for all other CT instructors on the secondary level and post-secondary level, if your programs are full, we have dormitories up at North Idaho College. A brand new $20 million CTE facility that can take them all. So please send them our way. That's the whole point of the alignment. Their credits will transfer to us too. So thank you.
Thank you.
Gene Ward from the ISU. I wish I had that problem of being so full like that, but I'm part of this process right now. and I love the way it's working out and the alignments all the way through that. But my goal is, this is more of a comment than a question, my goal is to get the enrollment up. I need to have those high school students starting there and then moving through into my program so I get my numbers up and get that enrollment up, because not only am I being selfish to have the enrollment up, but it's also a great opportunity for these students to get a good skill so they can go to work. So, yes, I wish I had that problem of too many and breaking down walls to do more, but I think this is also a great opportunity for those of us who really need to have that enrollment go up.
Great. I think for your standpoint, I think where we're aligned from the secondary to post-secondary programs, that gives you the opportunity to come into our programs, and you know where we're at with our curriculum, and you can come in and maybe find that lesson plan that's that wow factor that's gonna kind of steer somebody in your direction. So it affords you that opportunity, and another good thing about the alignment process.
Mark?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'd like to just echo off of that and tell you guys that I've had an opportunity to go through this as well. And really the way that this works is if you guys get behind it. We're given a great opportunity here to be able to work with industry as well as post-secondary and even secondary as far as collaboration within our high school programs. I teach diesel. And so I get an opportunity to work with all of the diesel instructors at a high school level. I also have an opportunity to work with all of the college or post-secondary instructors. And the collaboration in regards to, maybe I need something for my classroom or my lab, and maybe one of them have an extra piece, or they know where to get it from their industry or their advisory committee. This online career technical education, I think that's what it's all about. It's giving us an opportunity to outreach and talk amongst ourselves and have those opportunities. I don't know that any one place, even at the state level, has all the answers, but I do know this. It's in our nature as individuals that we teach this stuff. We're problem solvers. And a lot of times we have questions, why? Where can I get that? What can I do? And you know, it's amazing what happens when your industry finds out, or for example, I needed a piece of equipment. There was a place local that I wasn't aware of, and through my advisory committee, they said, you know, we can get that for you, Ron. It's a little cost. Susan has been great to work with. I know that she's been kind of ramrodding a little bit of this, and she has been excellent to work with. Everything that I've asked for in need of support, she's come forth and done so. All of the instructors up here, it's a good thing. But again, it would only be what you make it. Taking a step forward and taking an interest in what you see here. And you know, what do you want? What do you need? And this is a great way to help get those things. So I would encourage you, just what they're promoting here, get involved, get engaged, meet those college instructors, meet your industry, your advisory committee, and your post-secondary or secondary instructors as well. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Ron. One more question, Jules.
Hi, Jules Carpenter, Campus School District Administrator. I'm wondering, as we're doing this work, are we being purposeful in including a common core so we can flip education on its head and that everything else is supporting us? I'm wondering why social studies is required for 4 years, but CTE is not. And that in Mark Perna's tree, that academics is the root that supports what we do. So are we being purposeful and not very specific in, you know, career and technical, including all of the Common Core standards? So again, we're required and everything else is an elective.
I guess I would say we're not necessarily intentional about including the Common Core standards. I've worked with SDE, and based on my work with them, which it's been limited, most of my experience is post-secondary, but my understanding is that a lot of Common Core is shifts in instruction. And so that's difficult for us to write into standards. And so we really have to rely on the training that's happening at the school district level for the Common Core training, Number one, we don't want to get in the way of what the school district is doing, and so we try to encourage our CTE teachers, make sure you're embedded in what's happening in your district with Common Core so that you understand those shifts in instruction, and you can work closely with your academic cohorts so that you understand, you know, how can I incorporate the math and the writing skills and the reading skills into my programs, because we know, number one, we know the applied learning is so important to so many students, and we also know that the rigor and what's expected of a CTE student in terms of communication and math is probably a lot higher than what's required of a liberal arts student. So it's, we don't want to stand in the way of what's happening at the district level. It's up to the district and the teachers to work together with that.
And I'll add one more thing to that from a standpoint of not necessarily Common Core, but for basic academic understanding, especially in the area of critical reading and writing and math skills. In looking at the 3,061 workplace readiness assessments that were taken last year, our largest areas of improvement lie in those two skill sets. This is a statewide exam that was taken, the 3,000 students that did take it last year. Those were some of our weakest areas, where that critical reading and writing and those math skills that students need to have to be successful in the technical arena, because let's face it, they are required. Most of the reading that's done out of an auto manual or a pre-engineering notebook are much higher level than a liberal arts environment, and much higher level than what you would see in a senior or even freshman, sophomore, collegiate classroom in an English classroom. So those technical manuals are very, very difficult to read. They're not written at a ninth grade reading level. They're usually written at that age level of 18 to 25. So those are critical things that we have to think about when we work with our students. I'm going to ask one more. We've got one more question here.
I'm Mariella Nurse, and I'm an instructor at the South Idaho Correctional Institution. There are 11 of us here from corrections. And my question is this. For many of our men and women in the correctional system, post-secondary education might be more realistic for them in the area of registered apprenticeships, recognized OJT programs. Down the road, do you see any sort of, say, alignment project that would directly work with, say, apprenticeships, aligning what we're teaching, whether it's in corrections or the secondary level, with what employers, what industries are looking at in the areas of apprenticeships, as opposed to post-secondary classroom instruction. And I realize that a number of our post-secondary institutions are looking at adding more registered apprenticeships, is my understanding, or that might be down the road. If that might be an area for discussion, and I hope my question is making sense.
It is totally. Susan, you want to take that?
I think on-the-job training, one of the things, and this is my personal perspective, I don't know that I'm an expert in this at all, but lots of times with the apprenticeship training and the job training, they just go out to work and the employer decides what they need to know. And I think once we get the programs done, that's probably something we need to look at. We started this year with electrical apprenticeship programs, and we've identified the standards for the four-year apprenticeship programs, five-year actually when it's offered through the union people. But we identified those standards that needed to be included in the apprenticeship programs. They've been approved by the electrical board now, and so this year moving forward, we're going to create end-of-year assessments for I believe all 4 years. At one time we talked about doing, maybe it's just the first 3 years and then the fourth year is a journeyman's exam, but we're going to be working on those assessments this year. People who were at the board meeting were very excited, and so I think there are other apprenticeship programs that are going to come to us and start talking to us about doing that. But we need industry to buy into that because they drive the apprenticeship. So the electrical one was the first one out the door.
If I could, I'd like to respond to that question as well, just briefly, but we're very interested in expanding apprenticeship opportunities in Idaho and expanding into non-traditional apprenticeships as well. We're partnering with the Idaho Department of Labor and with the U.S. Department of Labor and applying for grants to give us some additional resources so that we can expand those opportunities and build those in non-traditional areas. So we're aggressively looking at apprenticeships and expanding those opportunities at all levels in Idaho, both secondary and post-secondary. And I think including our correctional institutions would be a wonderful idea.
So as we wrap up the panel, I know we're going to turn you guys loose on a little break and draw for some prizes here one last time. I want to ask one last question to the panel real quickly, 10 seconds, maybe one word if you can, starting with them, we'll work our way to the right. What do you see as the greatest challenge to a successful program alignment as we move forward?
The biggest challenge is worries that you're going to get all your curriculum changed, but it's not that. You go into it, everyone's like, oh no, everybody teaches the same thing, it's just coordinating it together. That's what it is.
Collaboration, cooperation, communication, and implementation.
Dang, those are great adjectives. Symbiotic. Working symbiotically, I think, is really the biggest key. And it's tough. People don't necessarily do that real well. In some of our facets of industry, it's not particularly something they need to work on in their job. It's a sole position, and they're not used to it. So, yeah, I mean, open mind, it's huge.
I would say be flexible, be willing to compromise with one another because we all have great ideas and we have to learn to work together.
Consistent participation.
I'd say a positive attitude and just keep the end in mind, you know, what we're trying to accomplish. to me, it felt like we simplified things. Took a lot of weight off my shoulders. Seems like we have a relevant curriculum and relevant lessons that we can pursue.
I guess I can't stress the importance of industry involvement. We want them at the table when we're setting the standards. We want them involved when we send out a survey to have them provide their input at that point. And then secondly, implementation.
And I think I would add one last thing, which would be your involvement. As instructors in the field, as administrators, making sure that your teachers are sitting at the table, make sure you're giving them the time to get there. We're providing all the funding, we're providing the stipends, we're providing all the costs to make this happen. And ultimately, it will be good for our students, and that's who we care about. So it's your involvement that will make it successful, and I think right now that's the greatest challenge. When you get the call from the program manager, hey, we're looking for somebody to come down and help us with standards on XYZ programming, be the first one at the table and get involved. I mean, I'd much rather have to turn people away than have to go out and beg to get somebody there because they just think they're too busy to make this work. Okay, so we really appreciate your time this morning. I appreciate the panel's time. Appreciate your work on this. I appreciate all the questions that came in. I look forward to this. We're going to, I think, break right here. We're going to draw some things. Remember, you have to be in the room to win the trip to win the 50-50. You have to be in the room to win the trip to Vegas. You have to be in the room. I think we're going to draw those now. Thank you very much.